Weidenfeld and Nicholson presents The Good Germans, Resisting the Nazis, 1933 to 1945. Written by Catrine Clay. Read by Karin Kass. Introduction. The Good Germans. My father always said there were no good Germans. I suppose you can understand it. He fought them for 5 years during the Second World War. In fact, that view was widespread among his generation. There was something wrong with the German psyche, a sort of Teutonic fatal flaw. At first I didn't take much notice, too busy with my own life. Later I got to thinking, but surely there were Germans and there were Nazis and they were not the same thing. Later still I learned that 2/3 of Germans, some 20 million people, had never voted for the Nazi Party, as the National Socialist German Workers' Party was known. The near-hysterical crowds featured in the newsreels of the time, screaming Sieg Heil and throwing bouquets of flowers as Hitler drove past in his black Mercedes, never amounted to more than a few hundred thousand. The membership of the Nazi Party, when they came to power through a fateful coalition of right-wing parties in 1933, was some 2 million. For them, Hitler was their Führer, the man who would lead them out of their desperate lives following Germany's humiliating defeat in the First World War and the chaos of the Weimar years which followed. But what of those 2/3 of Germans who did not vote for the Nazis and had to live through the Nazi terror regime, then the Second World War, and then, once it was all over, suffer the opprobrium of the whole world as more and more of the atrocities perpetrated by the Nazis became public knowledge, extermination camps and all. Not to mention their own feelings of guilt, because many of those good Germans ended up believing it had all been their fault. What of them? I've been working on the Nazi period off and on for many years, first at the BBC making history documentaries, then in writing books. Now I've come to the subject which has been hovering all these years. What of those 2/3? How would I have managed if I'd to live through that terror regime? Any terror regime, for that matter, knowing that even the slightest indication that I wasn't a committed Nazi could have lost me my job or got me sent to a concentration camp, or shot, or hanged, or guillotined. What would any of us do? Within just 6 months of the Machtergreifung, the seizure of power, on the 30th of January 1933, Germany's democracy had been replaced by the Nazi regime. No more political parties, trade unions, independent judiciary, civil service, free press, or independent churches. The policy of Gleichschaltung, brought in by March 1933, meant those who were not politically aligned, teachers, doctors, civil servants, were removed from their jobs, and if they persisted in opposing the regime, arrested, sent to a concentration camp, shot while trying to escape, or simply shot on the spot. Many Jews had already lost their jobs. The Volksgericht, the People's Court, was set up early in 1934 as an alternative legal system to bypass the traditional judicial system, specifically for acts of treason. Treason could be anything from not giving the Heil Hitler salute with sufficient zeal to taking part in a full-scale plot to assassinate Hitler. War was always part of the grand plan for the Nazis, as Hitler wrote in Mein Kampf as early as 1925, in order to gain Lebensraum, the space for living necessary to bring about the triumph of the master race, and what Hitler referred to as the thousand-year German Reich, or Third Reich, the natural successor to the Holy Roman Empire, First Reich, and the German Empire, Second Reich. As the terror regime took hold, most of those Germans who weren't Nazis just tried to keep their heads down and protect their families. They moved to the country or pretended to support the regime to avoid being denounced by neighbours. And they tried to work out what was really happening in the Reich, surrounded as they were by Nazi propaganda and fake news. But hundreds of thousands of Germans, mostly unknown, decided to resist the regime in large ways and small. Communists, social democrats, Catholics, Protestants, Quakers and Jehovah's Witnesses, teachers, shopkeepers, Prussian aristocrats, priests, army officers, factory workers, mothers, grandfathers, each risking their lives every day during that time. a period which lasted no more than 12 years, but which cost millions of lives. Once power gets into the wrong hands, there is little the individual can do. So I decided to write a book about those good Germans who tried to resist the Nazis in small ways and large. But how? I didn't want to write the big history again, the one about Hitler and Himmler and Goebbels. I wanted to write about people like you and me. Reverse things. Write the small history big and the big history small. But where to find such small personal stories of quiet courage? The unknown stories, based on memoirs, many unpublished. Luckily, my years of interest stood me in good stead. I knew where to look. And I speak German. This is not to ignore the famous stories of resistance to Nazi rule, like the White Rose Group in Munich, but more to show that there were hundreds of thousands of other unknown people acting at the same time. So the book starts in 1932, in the lead-up to the January 1933 Machtergreifung, and ends in 1946, when everything, the terror regime, the war, all the destruction and downfall, and the millions of dead, was over, though far from done. I decided on 6 characters, making them as wide a selection as possible. Workers and aristocrats, communists and conservatives, women and men, young and old. Because their actions inevitably affected the people around them, they are not seen in isolation but as part of their families. A brother and sister, a wife, a father with 3 children, an only son, the parents of a communist pioneer daughter. Their stories are interwoven throughout the book, each experiencing the big events of Nazi history as they unfold in their own small lives. Good Germans, all. The Good Germans. Bernd Engelmann is a schoolboy living in Düsseldorf in 1932 at the start of this story. His father is a businessman, his mother a housewife. He is an only child. The family is an ordinary German family, generally social democrat, but not especially political or religious. They join a local clandestine resistance group made up of people like themselves. A teacher, a tailor, a lawyer, a pastor, and led by Tante Nai, Aunt Nai, who runs the bakery and cafe on the corner of their street, welcoming everyone, including local Nazis, who never suspect this old woman who used to treat them well in their poor days, before they rose and rose to unheard-of positions of power and influence. The Engelmanns' reason: they simply cannot countenance what they see happening all around them under the new terror regime. And for that, they risk their lives. Fabian von Schlabrendorf is a law student in Berlin, serious-minded and quietly determined. His father died when Fabian was 16 and his mother was left to bring up her 5 children on her own. The family are anti-Nazi from the very beginning. When we first meet Fabian in 1933, after the Nazi Machtergreifung, he is walking across Berlin in search of a man he doesn't know and has never met, a man from a very different background to his own privileged one. Ernst Nikisch, the editor of a magazine called Widerstand, Resistance. Fabian is looking for like-minded people to start fighting the Nazis, whoever they are. Among the secret resistors, the traditional class divisions are breaking down. Factory worker and Prussian aristocrat, working hand in hand, finding they have much more in common than they ever realized. Rudolf Ditzen is a middle-aged man, already famous as the author Hans Fallada, best known for his novel Alone in Berlin. But he is also a morphine addict, drinker, liar, and womanizer, who killed a friend in a duel when he was young and has done time in prison for embezzlement. He has been in several clinics and lunatic asylums, trying to cure him of his addictions. Rudolf is married to the strong and long-suffering Zusa, and they have 3 young children. They live in Karwitz, a rural hamlet in Mecklenburg in northern Germany, where Rudolf writes furiously day and night, chain-smoking all the way. His subject, time and again, is the decent little people of Germany who have somehow to manage their difficult lives. This is his act of resistance, reaching out to his readers. Not for him acts of great courage. "I am a weak man, but not a bad man," he wrote to his mother. The problem for Rudolf is how to keep going under this Nazi terror regime, without making too many compromises and still remaining true to his liberal convictions. Irma Thälmann is 13 in 1932, the daughter of Ernst Thälmann, the charismatic leader of the KPD German Communist Party. In 1933, Thälmann is immediately arrested with some 10,000 other communists. He will spend 11 and a half years in solitary confinement before being vengefully executed just before the Russians arrive in March 1945. Irma is an only child living with her mother, Rosa, in Hamburg, with both grandfathers, old communist comrades living not far away. Irma is a fighter, the very image of her father. She'd rather get beaten every day at school than give the Heil Hitler salute. Mother and daughter are active resistors throughout, till the Gestapo finally catch up with them. Meanwhile, there are rare visits to her father, and occasional letters, and his speeches which they read again and again. "We know a land where there is no fascism," Ernst Thälmann declaimed. "A land where it would be unthinkable for the fascist hounds to practice murder on the streets, carrying out their bloody actions in the working-class districts. It is called the Soviet Union." Fritz Dietloff von der Schulenburg, Fritzi, is getting married to Charlotte when we first meet him in March 1933. He is 31, a Prussian aristocrat, energetic, clever, popular, idealistic, and a convinced Nazi. Like so many Germans from any background, he is still smarting from the brutal and humiliating terms of the Treaty of Versailles following defeat in the First World War, and from the wholesale collapse of the German economy after the Wall Street crash of 1929. He hopes the National Socialists will make Germany great again. He believes in their stated socialist aims. The day before Fritzi's wedding, Hermann Göring summons him to a meeting. The Nazis need top men on side. So pleased is Göring with the young, clever count, he takes him into the next room to meet the Führer. By 1934, Fritzi is already having doubts, strongly encouraged by his sister, Tisa, the passionate socialist in their family of Nazis. By 1938, Fritzi has joined General Beck's secret group of resistors and is ready to lose his life for the cause. Julius Leber was a leading social democrat in the Reichstag before the Nazis came to power, when they immediately banned all political parties other than their own. 2 hours after our victory, Dr. Leber will be hanging from a lamppost in the market square, jeered the Nazis in Lübeck, Leber's hometown. But Leber, a large, ebullient, tough man, isn't easily frightened. When the result of the right-wing coalition is broadcast, handing Hitler and the Nazis their Machtergreifung, he goes out on the town and gets drunk. In the early hours, he gets into a street brawl with some local Nazis, after which he is arrested and incarcerated indefinitely. His devoted wife, Anna Dora, when refused a visiting permit, finds a spot on a nearby rooftop to watch him during his daily hour of exercise in the prison yard. When he's finally let out in 1937, after being repeatedly beaten and tortured, the Nazis think they'll have no more trouble from Dr. Leber. But he goes straight back to the fight, knowing full well what it will likely cost him in the end. Chapter 1. The Swastika. Bernd Engelmann was greeted by a surprising sight when he arrived at his gymnasium, grammar school, one Monday morning in May 1932. A swastika flag was flying high up on a turret of the school building for all to see. The playground was full of students and teachers gazing upwards, astonished. A senior master said, "Get that thing down at once, it's a disgrace." The janitor just grinned. He couldn't find the key to the turret, he said. Then they saw a shaming sight. Their French teacher, Dr. Levy, who only had one arm, was clambering out of a dormer window and groping his way across the roof. He climbed the fire ladder and somehow hauled himself over the iron railing surrounding the turret and tore the flag down. They knew it was Dr. Levy because they could see the empty sleeve of his jacket flapping. The playground burst into applause, all but a few who booed and hissed. Bounce class had French for the second period that day, but Dr. Levy never said a word, just carried on with his irregular verbs as though nothing had happened. Except that when he slid the front blackboard across to write on the one behind, he found the words "salope juif" scrawled there in bold white chalk. He turned to face the class.
"Did one of you write that?" "No? I believe you."
He went on to explain that salope meant sow, so being feminine, juif should have been juive. Then he took the sponge and wiped it off, replacing it with manchot juif. Manchot was the French term, he explained, for a veteran of the war who had lost an arm, as he had in 1917 at the Battle of Arras. Bernd was 12 at the time, and when he got home for the midday meal, he told his parents what had happened. His father was a businessman in imports and exports, his mother a busy housewife. They were average middle-class social democrats, and Bernd, their only child, had grown up during the virtual civil war of the Weimar Republic, when the paramilitary fascist Freikorps, essentially private armies formed of war veterans, routinely fought pitched street battles with the communists and socialists, the pavements covered in blood. The Engelmann parents were shocked by what Bernd told them. Even more so that evening, when it transpired that the school principal, a suspected Nazi sympathizer, instead of punishing the perpetrators, had suspended Dr. Levy until further notice. Bernd's father nodded.
"That's the sort of thing that happens these days."
Still, in the Reichstag elections that November 1932, the Nazis' Nationalist Socialist Party lost 34 seats, failing to get the majority it needed, in spite of a massive propaganda campaign orchestrated by Dr. Joseph Goebbels, with all the usual staged events, blaring loudspeakers, declamatory speeches, military bands, marching Freikorps, hearty singing and nighttime torchlight processions, and the usual street violence. Bernd's father, listening to the election results on the wireless in the front room of their house in the suburbs of Düsseldorf, thought the outcome showed that Germans had some sense after all. But he spoke too soon. Through a series of dubious right-wing coalitions, Hitler was appointed Chancellor of Germany in President Hindenburg's government on the 30th of January 1933. The Engelmanns had a friend who was a doctor working in the emergency department of their local hospital. He told them they'd been completely overwhelmed that evening with the injured, many of them seriously wounded. The triumphant Nazis had gone on a rampage of violence, attacking communists, socialists, and Jews with anything they could lay their hands on. Steel balls covered in leather, knuckle dusters, horsewhips. And this in Dusseldorf, where the Social Democrats traditionally had the upper hand. Apparently, Felix Fechenbach, editor of the Volksblatt, the Social Democrat paper, was badly beaten, then arrested and taken into protective police custody. Later they heard he'd been shot while trying to escape. On the 30th of January 1933, the Engelmann family stayed safe at home, like two-thirds of the population and quite unlike that remaining third. Filmed for the newsreels by Dr. Goebbels' propaganda machine, cheering hysterically as their Führer drove through the streets of Berlin in his open-topped car, hand raised in the Hitler salute. Bernd's father shook his head and went into the other room to listen to the wireless broadcast.
"Like a blazing fire, the news spreads across Germany. Adolf Hitler is Chancellor of the Reich. A million hearts are aflame. Rejoicing and gratitude pour forth. A procession of thousands is streaming up Wilhelmstrasse, 100,000 voices shouting joyously, Sieg Heil, into the night."
Herr Engelmann sunk his head in his hands. It was unbelievable. Even the voice of the commentator was different, louder, more strident.
"They will destroy everything. Law, order, civilization, everything we value," he said.
The Reichstag was in uproar after the election. Called in desperation by the Weimar government, still beset with the economic and social problems following Germany's defeat in the Great War of 1914-18 and the punishing terms of the 1919 Treaty of Versailles, which followed, and made even worse by yet another disastrous economic crisis caused by the 1929 Wall Street crash.
The worst year had been 1923, when hyperinflation was so high people were paying a million marks for a sack of potatoes. Following the Dawes Plan of 1924, which fixed German war reparations at 50 billion gold marks, agreed a loan from America, and negotiated the withdrawal of French and Belgian troops from the Ruhr so the German coal and steel industry could recover, the economy had gradually steadied, until the reverberations of the Wall Street crash, at which point everything was up in the air again. The result? Constant disruption by violent extremists, both left and right, the left blaming the capitalists, the right blaming the communists and the Jews. By 1930, there was another plan, the Young Plan, reducing repayments by 20%. But the folk, the ordinary people, were close to starvation by then, with everyone looking for a saviour. In the previous July 1932 election, the NSDAP, Nazi Party, had won a huge 37.27% of the vote and 230 of 584 seats. And there was every expectation that they might reach the 293 seats needed for a majority at the next election, especially if Dr. Goebbels continued his good work. To everyone's amazement, the turnout for the November election was over 80% of the population, which said something important about the feelings of the German people at the time, though no one knew quite what. But it was the communist KPD, led by the charismatic Ernst Thälmann, pointing constantly to the dangers and volatility of the capitalist system, which quite unexpectedly gained 11 seats, while the Nazis and Social Democrats lost theirs. Deputies in the Reichstag were stunned. Thälmann and his comrades triumphant. At last, the working man had woken to the fact that only the uncompromising communists had the answer and that the Social Democrats' endless political compromises had let them down. By 1932, there were 6 million unemployed in the Reich and 27,000 farmers had gone to the wall. In Berlin, 3/4 of the population lived in a single room, children and all. The democracy of the Weimar years had manifestly failed to solve the desperate poverty, political chaos and deep post-war disillusionment. So, apart from those traditional patriots who voted for the conservative DNVP, the German National People's Party, Germans turned to more extreme political parties to solve their problems, polarizing the nation even more. The workers tended to vote left, either SPD, Social Democrat Party, or the communist KPD. But now they shifted decisively to the communists, with the Social Democrats losing 12 seats. The workers constituted 45.9% of the population, but only 28% of them voted for the Nazi Party. It was the lower middle class, shopkeepers and white-collar workers who voted for the Nazis, making up 1/4 of the party's membership, even though they were only 12% of the population. Hitler decided it was time to employ other means as soon as possible. Ban democracy, ban the Reichstag, ban the communists and the socialists, blame and kill the Jews. Anyone who had ears to listen or eyes to read Hitler's political manifesto Mein Kampf, My Struggle, published in 2 volumes in 1925 and 1927, could have foreseen it. There was a whole chapter on Eastern policy. The racially pure German folk would need Lebensraum, Hitler wrote, land to live in, and that would come from expansion to the east, into Poland and Russia, and this of necessity meant war. Not just against the non-Aryan subhuman Slav, but also against communism. As to the Jews in Germany, as soon as I have the power, I shall have gallows after gallows erected, for example in Munich on the Marienplatz, Hitler told his cronies in one of his private table talks in the early 1920s. Then the Jews will be hanged one after another, and they will stay hanging until they stink. They will stay hanging as long as hygienically possible. As soon as they are untied, then the next group will follow, and that will continue until the last Jew in Munich is exterminated. Exactly the same procedure will be followed in other cities until Germany is cleansed of the last Jew. In Hamburg, Ernst Thälmann, meanwhile, addressed his own comrades at a communist mass gathering on the 10th of July, 1932. There is no greater or more shameful lie to the masses than when they are told, the fascists will soon enough run out of steam, just let them carry on. Any such comment must be noted and rejected in the strongest terms. It is a slap in the face to all anti-fascists and social democratic workers. We are witnessing a growing fascist movement in Germany, an increase in fascism in the workplace and within our military, and an increase in their votes. They not only employ the most brutal methods to suppress the worker, but also prepare for a war against the Soviet Union. In Berlin, a Referendar law student, Fabian von Schlabrendorf, was trying to make sense of what was happening to the Germany he knew and loved. Fabian was 25, dark-haired, serious-minded, clever, bespectacled, with the quiet confidence bestowed by a happy childhood. His family was Prussian nobility, though not one of the foremost like the Bismarcks or the Moltkes. Nor were they even especially well off, but everyone knew everyone else in those circles, many loosely related too. The families owned large country estates, sometimes entire villages, their titles of Graf or Freiherr or Baron passing seamlessly from father to eldest son. Apart from running their estates, the fathers might also hold positions high up in the Prussian civil service or hold rank in the Prussian army. Politically, they tended to be conservative, voting for the DNVP, German National People's Party, or the Centre Party, and as a class, they believed in the traditional values of honour and patriotism, family, duty, social responsibility, decency, and the natural order of things, whereby the Prussian nobility stood above and the rest of the folk somewhere below. Theirs was a paternalistic society, and all the better for it, they agreed. On Sundays, the whole family attended church, mostly Protestant but some Catholic, taking up the front pews with their villagers and estate workers standing respectfully in the rows behind. The turbulent years of the Weimar Republic had left them with extremely mixed feelings about democracy. They were used to Kaisers, and their hero was Bismarck, iron fist and all. The Republic was too weak, they felt, leaving the Reich and the Volk in confusion and conflict. So they held firmly to their Prussian heritage, their kith and kin. If their sons didn't enter one of the regiments in the Prussian army, they would likely begin their studies in law, after attending a gymnasium and getting a good grounding in the classics, the law being the gateway to everything else. This was Fabian's story. By 1932, he was living in the family's apartment in Berlin and continuing his law studies. The Schlabrendorfs were Prussian soldiers on both sides, but Fabian was minded to make his future elsewhere, perhaps in a legal department of the Prussian civil service. He entertained rather left-wing views for someone of his background, and he was determined to make his own way. In fact, he had little choice in this. His father, 20 years older than his mother, had died when Fabian was 16. He was the only boy, with four sisters, and their mother had to struggle to make ends meet. Fabian's father had been traditional in his views, holding little sympathy for the Weimar Republic. As a soldier, he knew Germany needed a strong leader and a strong army. Few of his fellow army officers would have disagreed, but not many shared his reasons, that the army's first and last task was to avoid war, not to make it. Fabian was just a boy in 1914 when the Great War broke out, but he remembered the heady jubilation. Not his father. "The German Reich will lose this war," he'd warned, "and the monarchy with it." Everyone thought von Schlabrendorf was giving vent to his well-known pessimism, but as times got harder, food scarcer, and victories fewer, people saw that he was right. When he died, he left Fabian a copy of Oswald Spengler's Der Untergang des Abendlandes, The Decline of the West, the book everyone was reading at the time, written in the shadow of war. Fabian kept it with him always. It gave him spiritual guidance for the rest of his life. If Fabian's father was a silent man, his mother was the polar opposite. A born talker and not very circumspect about it either. When her husband warned that Germany would lose the war, she told anyone who cared to listen, causing quite a stir. She was energetic, vivacious, warm, rebellious by temperament, and adored by all five children. And by her quiet husband, who called into account for his wife's unpatriotic talk, refused to apologize for her, saying she was entitled to her opinions like anyone else. Frau von Schlabrendorf became a fervent Nazi hater early on. Some years later, the Nazis tried to award her the Cross of Honor of the German Mother. To gain such a medal, you had to prove your racial purity back to the grandparents and have at least four children. It was known derisively by the man in the street as the Order of the Rabbit. Frau von Schlappendorf had 5 children and was living in straitened circumstances since her husband died. As such, she might have been awarded something more than just a medal. A larger apartment, perhaps, recently vacated by a Jewish family. But when the local Nazi officials came to congratulate her, Frau von Schlappendorf greeted them with, "I suppose you come to take me away to a concentration camp." And that was that. So on that day, in 1932, Fabian was walking across Berlin in search of a man he didn't know and was unlikely to meet in the normal course of events, their social backgrounds being entirely different. He'd come across a journal titled Widerstand, Resistance, edited by Ernst Niekisch, a leading light of a movement called National Bolshevism. This was loosely linked to the KPD Communist Party and brought together disparate forces in Germany, which all, for their varied reasons, rejected the terms of the Treaty of Versailles, preferred Soviet to American power, yet also supported German nationalism. Fabian knew that Niekisch had helped to set up the short-lived Bavarian Soviet Republic in 1919, during the virtual civil war which engulfed Germany following the war, and that he'd served a term in prison for his support of the revolution in Bavaria. And he knew that Niekisch was nominally a member of the SPD, but that he rejected their stated pacifism and was therefore expelled from the party in 1926, which was when he started Widerstand. In 1932, he published a pamphlet, Hitler, Ein deutscher Verhängnis, Hitler, Germany's fateful downfall, an outspoken attack on Nazism. And this is why Fabian was now seeking him out. Fabian had read Mein Kampf in Halle, the university where he'd started his law studies. Halle was an odd choice for a young man with left-wing leanings because even then it was a hotbed of right-wing extremism with a flourishing local Nazi party. But Uncle Alfred, his mother's only brother, lived there. Uncle Alfred was a steadying influence, always the same, one of those people liked and respected by everyone, whatever their background or political leanings. He was a senior civil servant, a liberal and a confirmed bachelor. In 1933, when the Nazis were still keen to appear on the right side of the law, they offered him the job of president of police in Halle, but he refused. That showed Fabian you could be an official in the Third Reich, but not give way to the Nazis. And Uncle Alfred never did give way, even as late as 1944, when he publicly supported friends involved in the 20th of July plot to assassinate Hitler. Likewise, when Fabian was finally arrested and incarcerated in the Gestapo headquarters in Prinz Albrechtstrasse, Uncle Alfred travelled from Halle to Berlin to visit him. Fabian had started his law studies at Halle at his uncle's instigation because it was an excellent university with a renowned library, where he found Mein Kampf. Any doubts he may have had were instantly banished. From now on, he would fight the Nazis however he could. But where to start? His relations and friends all came from similar Prussian backgrounds, and in 1932, most were still in search of a strong leader to release them from the chaos of Weimar democracy. Doggedly, Fabian searched around for people with other views and other aims. By the time he transferred to Berlin to pursue the next stage of his law studies, he'd discovered Widerstand. Ernst Niekisch wasn't expecting anyone when he heard a knock at his door in the Hallischen Ufer district of Berlin. An ordinary sort of place, a long way from the elegant district where the Schlabrendorfs had their apartment. When Niekisch opened the door, he saw a young man standing there. Obviously Prussian nobility, because these things can't easily be disguised, and quickly confirmed once Fabian began speaking. In his educated, cultured way, he apologized with a quick bow for his unannounced arrival, introduced himself, and explained his reasons for coming. For his part, Fabian saw before him a short, stocky, middle-aged, middle-class man with a tough, determined face. "He was probably the most important man ever to step into my life. Les extrêmes se touchent," as he put it later, referring to the powerful attraction of opposites. The two got on immediately, and it stayed like that until the day Niekisch died. Once inside the house, Fabian quickly saw he'd done the right thing and found the right man. Niekisch had a fine way with words, and he spoke them openly and directly, only concerned to put across his views with force and clarity. He never spoke down to Fabian, even though he was just a young student, but quickly set out to convince him there was another way of looking at things. For Fabian, it was his first proper encounter with a heart-and-soul Republican. Up till now, he'd only read about the kind of views held by Nikisch, which he recognised as loosely Marxist, but nationalist rather than internationalist. Now the man was there in the flesh, and Fabian knew for certain a new world stood before him. Years later, he still vividly remembered that first encounter.
"How did you find me?" asked Nikisch. "In Widerstand."
That told Nikisch he didn't have to start with the basics. This young man already knew them. Unlikely as it seemed, Fabian von Schrabendorf had come to the same conclusion as himself, that Hitler and the Nazis were a force of chaos and destruction for Germany, and that they had to be resisted at all costs. Nikisch thought a new era had to emerge out of the Weimar chaos, an era of the proletariat, of the working man, to counteract Hitler's populism with all its talk of Volk and race and war, and its hatred of the Jews. Fabian wondered briefly if Nikisch had some Jewish blood. Possibly. As to the proletariat, as far as Fabian could see, many of them were putting their hopes in the Nazis.
"Do you think Hitler's a kind of Napoleon III?" he asked.
"No, no," said Nikisch. "More Napoleon I. He'll draw the whole world into war. He'll start with great victories, waving that swastika flag before the final inevitable downfall and destruction."
He said that in 1932, Fabian later reminded himself, long before all the downfall and destruction. Fabian realised he had a lot to learn. To his surprise, Nikisch was no admirer of Gustav Stresemann, the Weimar politician who served as both Chancellor and Foreign Minister in the 1920s, guiding Germany through the crisis of hyperinflation caused by the harsh terms of the Treaty of Versailles. Like most Democrats, Schlabrendorf had admired how Stresemann, working with the Western Allies, was able to reduce the sum of war reparations, converting some into payment of raw materials such as coal and pig iron, and for his part in the negotiations between Germany and France over France's retreat from their occupation of Germany's industrial area of the Ruhr. But National Bolshevist Nikisch didn't agree. He was not impressed by this flirtation with the Western Allies, the very people who'd imposed such crippling terms on Germany. He preferred the terms of the 1922 Treaty of Rapallo between Germany and the new Soviet Socialist Republic, whereby the two governments agreed to cooperate to meet the economic needs of both, each renouncing territorial and financial claims. Publicly, the two sides had agreed to re-establish diplomatic relations. In secret, by 1926, they had also agreed some military cooperation. As secrets go, this was a big one. Nikisch was never for pacifism, and he deeply resented the fact that Germany was forbidden to rearm by the Treaty of Versailles, save for a basic army of no more than 100,000 men. By the time Fabian met him, Nikisch was acting as a secret liaison between Germany and Soviet Russia, working with Karl Radek, a communist who'd returned to Germany from Moscow in 1923, and started putting out feelers towards the remaining stump of the Reichswehr, German army. The plan was to secretly build up a panzer regiment and a fledgling Luftwaffe in Russia, blatantly breaking the terms of the Treaty of Versailles. How far the plan succeeded remains unclear, but one thing is certain. Nikisch enjoyed the protection of the German military well into the Nazi era. Of course, Fabian only discovered this later. For the time being, he was simply looking for others who felt as he did about the dangers of Nazism. The Volk was well and good, as Nikisch was wont to say, but it was only the state which had the right to rule. Fabian, with his Prussian background, could only agree. If all this was clear to Fabian, it was extremely unclear to a man called Rudolf Ditzen. Variously described as a thief, a liar, an alcoholic, a drug addict, and a womanizer, Rudolf lived on his nerves and was in a constant state of depression. Some said it dated back to a serious accident when he was a boy, which left him with headaches, dizzy spells, and trouble sleeping. Others said he was just born like that, causing trouble for his parents from the start. When he was 18, he underwent the first of many stays in a lunatic asylum after accidentally killing a friend in a duel, the result of a suicide pact which went wrong. In the 1920s, he did two short stints in prison for embezzlement. The Ditzens were a typical middle-class family.
the father a local magistrate in Greifswald, a town on the Baltic coast, the mother a housewife presiding over a household of four children with the help of a nursemaid and two servants. Rudolf was their third child, the one they never understood. Year after year, they tried to influence him, guide him, support him, often financially in later years, all to no avail. Rudolf careered from one crisis to another, often suicidal, always trouble. His teachers described him as a decadent person who seemed almost weary of life, who felt himself above the law. Arrogant, too, noted the school principal. It was especially puzzling because the parents were good, decent people. They liked books and music. They played the piano. They took their children to museums and the zoo. They had no idea what to do with their wayward son. By the time Rudolf finished studying at the gymnasium and the university, they just hoped and prayed he'd get a decent job, find a good wife, settle down. Instead, things only got worse. Rudolf drank more and more, became addicted to morphine and cocaine, smoked like a chimney, stayed out all hours, sometimes all night. He was plagued by a chronic restlessness. He couldn't sleep. He seemed to hate his parents. By now the family was living in Leipzig, following the father's promotion to the Supreme Court. Rudolf cast around for something to do. If nothing else, he had to earn some money. His father gave him a small allowance, but it was nothing like enough to cover his expensive tastes. Finally, he found a job as a steward on a local country estate. Then came the 1914-18 war, where he was not deemed fit enough to serve, and another job on another estate in Pomerania. The work suited him. He liked the farm workers, the ordinary people, and he liked the countryside, the woods, the fields, the solitude. It didn't change him, nothing could do that, but it suited him. Above all, it gave him time to do what he'd always wanted to do and knew he could do, write. All this time, and I only discovered this decades later, I was learning to become what I was going to be one day. A writer. Endless rows of chattering women weeding beet or lifting potatoes, and I heard these women and young girls chatting away all day. The same went for the boss and the dairymen and the labourers. I learned how they talked and what they talked about, and because I was just a lowly employee myself, they weren't shy with me. Rudolf started to write, without a publisher and without any clear plan. But gradually he found his subject. The ordinary folk, the Anständigen, decent people, the ones who were struggling to survive in the economic and political chaos of post-war Germany. He chose Hans Falada as his nom de plume, the name of a horse in one of the Grimm's fairy tales, a horse who always told the truth. A nice touch given his own slippery nature. Everything in my life ends up in my books, he told a radio interview in 1946. And this, in fact, is how Rudolf told the world the truth about what was going on in Germany, through his writing, if not always through his actions. The 1920s were as dramatic and chaotic for Rudolf as they were for Germany itself. One of Rudolf's brothers had been killed in the war, a devastating blow to all of them. In addition, Herr Ditzen's war bond investments were badly affected by Germany's defeat, resulting in a reduction of Rudolf's allowance. Where once the family enjoyed long summer holidays and winter skiing in the Alps, by the summer of 1923, with raging hyperinflation adding to their financial problems, they could only afford a short holiday, not least because of the expense of travel. The fourth-class railway tickets cost 58,000 marks on the way there and 580,000 marks on the way back. The next day, the price would have been 2,320,000 marks, as Herr Ditzen wrote to his son. Bad news awaited them when they got home. In July, Rudolf, perhaps making up for the shortfall in his allowance, was sentenced to 6 months in prison for embezzlement. His addictions to morphine and alcohol and tobacco all had to be paid for after all. In August 1923, there was a general strike, and the government fell. In Hamburg, there was a short-lived communist uprising, and in Munich, the fledgling Nazi party instigated the Beer Hall Putsch. Gustav Stresemann was soon replaced as chancellor, though not as foreign minister, and the next government was forced to bring in emergency legislation to try and quell the violent civil unrest. Rudolf was sunken-faced and sallow-skinned due to his addictions and his chronic chain-smoking. But he was like a cork on the high seas, tossed this way and that, but somehow always bouncing back to the surface. By 1924, he'd found a publisher, Ernst Rowoldt. Large in build and temperament, humorous, generous, Rowoldt was a man who could walk into any room and be immediately surrounded by friends. A publisher to his fingertips, he supported his writers through thick and thin. From jail, Rudolf airily asked Rowoldt to send him 6 volumes of Balzac. Rowoldt sent the books, adding a jovial note. The postage alone had cost him 116,760,000,000 marks. Rowoldt knew Rudolf was trouble, but he could also see that he was an exceptional writer. In December, he paid Rudolf 100 gold marks, the first of many advances and loans he would give him over the years. In prison, Rudolf was busy learning Oscar Wilde's Ballad of Reading Gaol by heart. Because of the emergency, the cell meant for one was full to bursting. By day he worked at chopping wood, by night he read and wrote till the light faded and the cockroaches emerged. Unfortunately, to gain favour with the prison guards, he grassed on his fellow jailbirds. "But that's life," he wrote to a friend, careless. "I have to survive. Let stronger men be heroes and martyrs. I only have enough talent to be a small-scale coward." If the stint in prison was meant to teach him a lesson, it didn't. He was hardly out and hardly into his new job on yet another country estate when he disappeared, along with 14,000 marks out of the till. Later, he forged a cheque for 10,000 marks and stole a further 5,000 marks. Then he gave himself up. He pleaded guilty to all charges and was sentenced to 2.5 years in prison. "A thoroughly degenerate psychopath," noted the magistrate. As far as Rudolf was concerned, prison was good news. The one thing he didn't want was to end up in another lunatic asylum. In prison, he could read and write, and perhaps even kick his addictions. He was already working on another novel, and now, guided by Rowoldt, he was writing essays and articles as well. He was increasingly concerned with the subject of the decent little man, struggling, poor, unfairly blamed and put upon, flung this way and that by fate and by political circumstances over which he had no control. Based on his own experience, he took up the cause of prison reform. "Prisoners who have served long sentences should not be released without adequate provision," he wrote in one of his articles. In his own case, the system worked well. When he was released in February 1928, the prisoner's welfare found him a job and accommodation in Hamburg. There he joined the SPD and started attending the Order of the Good Templar, an abstinence society, which helped him to give up his drugs. And there he met Zusa Issel, age 27, doing voluntary work, fair-haired, sweet-natured, strong, who changed his life. The Issels were part of the Anständigen, decent people Rudolf was minded to defend. Zusa worked as a milliner and belonged to a trade union. Politically, the family were social democrats, still hoping for a better world and a fairer society. The SPD did well in the 1928 elections, just before the Wall Street crash, becoming the largest party in the Reichstag, reflecting the fact that the government was finally managing to bring some stability to the economy. The Nazis' NSDAP only got 2.6% of the vote. Herr Ditzen's finances began to recover along with everyone else's. Rudolf wrote asking for more money to support his new life as a writer. Against his better judgment, but keen to give his son a chance, especially now that he had a publisher, Herr Ditzen agreed on a sum of 150 marks a month. On condition, he wrote to his mother regularly, enclosing a detailed budget. Rudolf bought a second-hand typewriter and set to work in his new lodgings in Hasselburgstrasse. He did some typing work for extra money and wrote to Rowoldt, inquiring after some work in his publishing office. Later, he moved back to Neumünster in Schleswig-Holstein, where he'd been living before prison, but he wrote to Zusa every day and visited Hamburg regularly. By December, they were engaged, the wedding set for April. "I have never been so happy in my whole life," Rudolf wrote to a friend. In Neumünster, he got some work on a local newspaper, writing up local events in the town and the surrounding countryside and reviewing films. It earned him some money, but more than that, it gave him the material for his next book, which first alerted the general reading public to Hans Fallada. Titled Bauern, Bonzen and Bommen, Farmers, Functionaries and Fireworks, and published in 1931, it was the story of a small provincial town, its people and its newspaper, and by Rudolf's own account, it was completely different to any of his previous novels. Much more political, committed to the little man buffeted by fate. It was Rudolf's way of making his views felt. If he wasn't strong or courageous enough to act, he could still write and reach millions of people in doing so. The book was really about poor Germany, not just poor farmers, as he wrote to his sister, Elisabeth. So here comes Tredup. On the first page of the book, in threadbare black coat and black felt hat, striding furiously along the street to his meagre job, selling advertising space on the local Chronicle newspaper, outraged at the unfairness and ignominies of his life. When he comes into the office, the secretary looks up briefly, sees who it is, and goes back to reading her romance. "Don't be like that, Clara, Clarabella, Clarissiama," he protests, reminding her that he saw her coming out of the grotto past midnight. "Well, if I'm to live off what he pays me," is her shameless reply. His readers knew what that meant. So many women had been reduced to prostitution to make ends meet after the latest economic crisis. Tredup asks after the boss's wife.
"Sozzled?"
"Yes." Out cold drunk in the courtyard, skirts up to her knickers for all to see. To amuse themselves, Tredup and his two colleagues, Venk and Stoff, come up with alternative titles for the newspaper. The Daily Smear, Swastika Sellout, Shithouse Square, Fart in a Phone Box, Read It and Sleep, Scandal Sheet. Apparently the police superintendent, who used to vote SPD, now a Nazi, was caught red-handed having it off with one of the cleaners that night in the Rathaus, the town hall. They were doing it on the mayor's desk. Naturally, that wouldn't make the pages of the Chronicle, he being the police superintendent and a Nazi to boot. Let's face it, there was corruption everywhere. No wonder the reading public was thrilled by Hans Fallada. They recognised their own lives, described with sharp humour and humanity. They could see it, and thanks to the writer's brilliant way with dialogue and voices, they could hear it too. The next scene hit home. Two bailiffs are on their way to Farmer P. They're off to auction two oxen because Farmer P can't pay his taxes. Another bankrupt. "I make them homeless after 1,000 years, the senior tells his junior. The book had turned its attention to the landfolk movement, an association of small farmers who'd banded together to protest about the effects of the economic crisis on their lives, driving 27,000 of them into bankruptcy. Schleswig-Holstein, where the imaginary Chronicle existed and the real Ditsons lived, was especially affected. The farmers couldn't get a proper price for their milk, meat, butter, or vegetables. They were falling into debt and unable to pay their taxes. Bankruptcy swiftly followed, with families who'd tilled the same land for generations becoming homeless after 1,000 years, as Rudolf's bailiff said. The same applied to local small businesses. By 1930, following the shock waves of the Wall Street crash, the NSDAP vote had increased from 4% to 27% in Schleswig-Holstein, the highest political shift in the land. Meanwhile, Rudolf Ditson, now 35, was happy for the first time in his life. Zuse was the perfect wife for him, strong, calm, and a good housewife. With her help, he cut out drinking and continued to resist the temptations of morphine and cocaine, limiting himself to chain smoking. During the day, he wrote. In the evenings, he read aloud to Zuse while she did the darning. His book was well reviewed and was actually making money. They were able to move to the Moabit district of Berlin, renting two furnished rooms with their own kitchen, which was just as well since they had their first child now, a boy called Uli, named after Rudolf's brother killed in the war. Rudolf's parents, daring to hope their son's life was finally steadying, upped his allowance. Better still, Rowoldt was able to offer Rudolf a part-time job in the reviews department at the office, earning 250 marks a month. Every morning he took the train from Bellevue Station, then walked the last stretch to Passauer Straße, starting work at 9 a.m, ending at 2 p.m. When he got home, he played with Uli. Then he wrote till late into the night, chain-smoking. Life really couldn't have been much better, at least for the time being. In Hamburg on the 10th of July, 1932, Irma Thälmann, aged 13, was having her hair done by her mother in preparation for their big outing. Her father, Ernst Thälmann, the charismatic leader of the KPD, the German Communist Party, had already left the house, accompanied by his comrades and bodyguard, for the Platz in the centre of the city, where he was going to address the crowds of workers gathered there. It was the first time Irma was allowed to attend such a mass meeting, dangerous as they usually were. She had already proved her dedication to the cause, her fervour fuelled by her devotion and profound admiration of her father. She'd insisted on joining the Red Young Pioneers when she was 6, though the normal age was 9. By the time she was 11, she was one of the leaders. When Thälmann looked at his daughter, his and Rosa's only child, he felt he looked at himself. "My parents often told me what terrible poverty there was in 1919 when I was born, in Hamburg-Eppendorf, Siemsenstrasse 4. Deep snow on the ground and no coal or wood to be had, our rooms ice cold," Irma would write in her memoir years later. Apparently her father always promised her mother that things would change. "A million children freezing like ours here now, and myself unemployed like nearly all other dock workers and millions of other German workers." The only way the Thälmann survived was with the help of friends and comrades and a small stipend from his trade union where he was treasurer. The flat was always a hive of activity, Irma recalled, nearly all of it political. Discussions, planning, conspiracies, plenty of secrets. Irma was told never to talk to anyone in the street about what went on in their home. It was too dangerous. How could a child tell between friend and foe? They didn't want her to know there were spies everywhere, watching every movement Vater made. She remembered being at home alone one evening when her parents were out at a meeting. Their flat was on the ground floor, and she was in bed fast asleep, when some men broke in, turned the cupboards and desk upside down, looking for incriminating political material. She slept through it all. When her parents came home, they asked her what happened. She had no idea. She never forgot their distressed expressions. Rosa should never have left her alone, she knew, but this was a most important meeting at a time of virtual civil war between left and right, and to Irma's parents' politics, the fight and the party had to come first. Later that same year, Irma and Mutti were already in bed, Vater out at yet another meeting, when the Freikorps consul unit threw a hand grenade through the window of their front room. It's just the way things were in those days. "My father was a fighter," Irma wrote. One evening, coming home at 2 a.m. from a meeting in a Hamburg suburb, he saw a suspicious guy lurking and beat him up. It was no contest. Ernst Thälmann was built like a tank and honed by years of street battle. Then another guy ran up to stop him. Apparently the one lying on the ground was a comrade, one of many placed at intervals on Thälmann's route between the station and home to give him protection from the Freikorps. No one had thought to tell him. They often laughed about it later, during rare evenings when Thälmann was home and not working on a speech or lecture, when they'd sit round the table, mother, father and daughter, and Irma learned the lessons she'd hold to for the rest of her life. They were magical evenings full of passionate talk and plenty of laughter. Sometimes her father would suddenly pull Irma up from the table and dance around the kitchen with her. Summer Sundays were the best. Vater would say they were going to the Blankensee, which was a beach on the Elbe where many Hamburg workers met to recover after a hard week, swimming, playing ball games, talking, discussing. Everyone knew everyone. Vater would be sitting there on the bank, happy among his friends and talking to the dock workers, hearing their worries, getting information, offering practical advice, and playing with the children. "Sport makes happiness," he'd say, "but it's also necessary to strengthen us for our daily battles." There were members of the SPD there too, and non-politicals, all Hamburg workers. They formed discussion groups, and there were often great disagreements when Vater intervened. "Think about it," he'd tell them. "The five fingers of your hand couldn't achieve much on their own. Only when they're made into a fist do they have power." Ernst Thälmann was full of energy and exuberance, always ready to fight. But it was clear the family had to move to a safer flat, not on a ground floor. So Irma's mother Rosa went searching everywhere on foot. There wasn't enough money for trams. Her father's modest expenses were funded by the party, but not Rosa's. Not many landlords wanted Ernst Thälmann in their buildings, but she never gave up. That was Rosa, as determined and committed in her way as her husband. Finally, she found rooms on a first floor in Tarpenbeckstrasse, near the centre of the city. Their new home quickly became another meeting place for the fighters, filled with constant activity and noisy discussion. In October 1923, Thälmann had led the Great Hamburg Uprising, the workers from the docks and the factories protesting against the lack of bread and employment and the hard repression by the authorities. It lasted 3 days and three nights, and Irma, aged four at the time, never forgot it. Women and children helped build the barricades using whatever they could find: stones, garden gates, trees, even furniture. There were hardly any weapons. Only a few of the partisans, as Irma's father called them, had rifles, firing on the police from the rooftops. The police had tanks as well as guns, and many fighters were killed. They attacked, were felled, and they attacked again. They never gave up, Irma recalled, nostalgic for those heady days. But there was no support for the KPD workers from the SPD, so the chance for change was lost. Hundreds of workers, men and women, were arrested, and many died at the hands of the right-wing Freikorps. On the 9th of November, there was a mass demonstration at the Ohlsdorf Cemetery to honour the dead. In spite of the danger, a stream of workers arrived. Irma's father was warned he'd be arrested if he appeared, but of course he went and addressed the workers. Irma went too. I went with mother. Great crowds were making their way to the cemetery. They were threatened by the commandos and the lorries of heavily armed police at the gates, and more police and criminal investigators in the cemetery. But the workers were well organised. Each comrade on protection duty knew exactly where to stand and what his job was. My father was nowhere to be seen. Suddenly, cheering rose from somewhere in the middle of the crowd. He appeared from nowhere and spoke in their midst, dispelling all sadness and praising the workers of Hamburg for their courage to great cheers, and then, just as suddenly, he disappeared into the masses, protected by an unbreakable chain of comrades. From 1924 onwards, Thälmann spent a lot of time in Berlin, taking up his position as KPD member in the Reichstag. Irma asked if she and her mother could move to Berlin too, but her father said no. His heart and home were in Hamburg, with the dock workers. Vater often travelled to the Soviet Union. When I was nine, he came back from Leningrad one day, and Mutti and I went to pick him up. Lots of comrades were there to meet him too, and once he'd finished talking to them, he whispered in my ear, "I've brought you something fine." He gave us his suitcases to take home and came along later. We didn't open the case, but were excited. He waited till we'd eaten, then unpacked. I got a pioneer outfit with red neckerchief and white blouse and a skirt. Mutti helped me put it on and showed Vater.
In the Soviet Union, the young pioneers have rules, and once you wear the uniform, you have to obey the rules, he told Irma.
All my friends were envious. I explained that the red neckerchief's three corners were a symbol of the three parts of the Communist Party, and the knot bound them fast. He also brought me some picture books and some beautiful wooden jigsaws of the Kremlin and the red flag. Irma's favourite evenings were when Vater had the time and inclination to sit at the kitchen table telling stories about his childhood.
Remember, Hamburg was a great city, a Hansestadt, free state, within the monarchy when I was growing up.
He'd tell Irma and Rosa, who'd heard it all before but still liked to hear it all again.
Blohm and Voss shipbuilders alone employed 10,000 dock workers building those great ocean liners for the Hamburg-America line. There were powerful trade unions and worker organisations, social as well as political. Hamburg had 1 million inhabitants and we were trading across the world. Rubber, wool, jute, copper, zinc, oil and products from our factories like margarine, chocolate and cigarettes. We had cotton mills and breweries, the greatest industrial output in the Reich. But of course, they were all capitalist enterprises with no interest or care for their workers who came in from the country, from Schleswig, Mecklenburg, Friesland, farmers and sailors and builders,
Strong, intelligent types who were soon demanding their rights, striking and demonstrating. The capitalists and authorities came down hard on them, imprisoning them and putting them on their blacklist. That's what happened to Großvater, Grandpapa, you know. And when he got out of prison, the only way he could provide for us was to go around the streets with a cart selling potatoes and coal. Then a horse and cart, then a cellar shop. It didn't stop him being politically active. Nothing could do that.
You could hear the deep admiration in Vater's voice. Talking in that spellbinding way of his, Irma listening wide-eyed, he said he had to help his own Vater from the age of 7, getting up at 4 a.m. on market days, looking after the horse, delivering door-to-door, in deepest snow of winter or the boiling heat of summer. He was good at school but had to leave at 14. There just wasn't the money. As soon as he could, he was off, as a stoker on one of the big ships to America. There he worked on a farm near New York. America taught him a thing or two about the workings of the capitalist system, he said, laughing. Such riches, such poverty. The farm employed Negroes, and their children weren't allowed to play with the white farmers' children. Even the Negro children had to work hard. When he came back to Hamburg, he joined the Transport Workers Trade Union, threw himself into it, organizing strikes and demonstrations. Soon he was the treasurer, then the branch leader, finally the leader. Sometimes strikes lasted for weeks, 18,000 workers all out, all holding together. Every spare minute he studied books on political theory and went to meetings. He loved the company and good company in general. He was 28 when the Great War broke out. He described it as a victory for the imperialists over the working man. The left, including the Social Democrats, were against the war. But the Tucsons and the bankers and the imperialists and Junkers won, he told Irma, and they got their war. That's what the youth of Europe on all sides was sacrificed for. The munition kings and finance princes. It was a terrible thing for the workers. A painful disillusionment, he said. He himself spent 2.5 years at the front. First at the Somme, then the N. He was forbidden home leave. That's how the imperialists solved their problem with the politically active worker. Kept them at the front, getting killed. He was wounded twice, but still no home leave. He quoted Karl Liebknecht. The main enemy of every people lies in their own country. The main enemy of the German folk is in Germany itself. German imperialism, the party of war. Finally, in summer 1917, he got home leave. He used the short time to read up about the Russian Revolution and revolution in Germany. He joined the Independent Social Democrats and voted against the war. Later, he left, taking 42,000 members into the Communist Party with him. In 1917, the sailors mutinied at Wilhelmshaven. Then came the October Revolution. He was back at the front by then, having to be careful with his anti-war activities, as he knew he was under surveillance. Another year with no home leave followed. When he finally returned to Hamburg in autumn 1918, he found starvation everywhere and strikes in the docks. Karl Liebknecht and Rosa Luxemburg were in prison, later murdered.
Europe had become a hell, he said. Millions of dead, millions of wounded, nameless suffering. Hunger. While the winners of the war, the captains of industry and the armaments factories made more and more profits.
On the 5th of November 1918, the Hamburg dock workers laid down their tools and marched on the city centre. In Hamburg alone, there were 8 different Freikorps units fighting the communists in the streets. They had names like Werewolf, Fredericus Rex, and Black Hunter. Filled with demoralised soldiers. Politically right-wing, certainly, but above all, demoralised with no jobs and nowhere else to go. They decided the left-voting working class was the reason Germany lost the war, and the Jews. They called it the stab in the back. They hated democracy. They wanted a military dictatorship. It was they who formed the foundations and structure of the Nazi Party. Then came the right-wing Kapp-Putsch. To their shame, the government briefly fled to Stuttgart, but the German folk stood up to them, answering the call for a general strike, downing all tools, no trains or trams, no factories, no lorries, no businesses, no ships setting sail, no dock workers. It was over in days. The failure of that revolution was due to the fact that the leaders of the German proletariat were divided, Vater explained to Irma. By the time she was 13, Irma was a hardened revolutionary. She'd been in the Young Pioneers for 7 years and witnessed for herself the poverty of families whose fathers were unemployed or who'd been killed in the uprisings or street battles. Every Christmas, she'd brought toys and food to those starving families donated by the party. Now, on the 10th of July 1932, wearing her Young Pioneers uniform, she was part of the throng of workers making their way to the Platz for the anti-fascist rally, holding tight to her mother's hand so as not to get lost in the crowd. Her father had gone ahead as usual, protected by the comrades. The mood was electric with anticipation. The workers didn't care about the Freikorps or the police, who were standing by with guns and fists at the ready. They just wanted to hear the voice of their great leader. Suddenly, a great cheer went up. Thälmann appeared in their midst, out of nowhere as usual. And then he began to speak, using a megaphone.
Don't believe the Social Democrats when they tell you that even if the fascists get into power, they won't last. No, this was a shameless lie. The fascists will never give up power once they have it, and they will prepare for another war. Everywhere we see not only the hard repression of the working man, but also preparation for war against the Soviet Union, he warned. What Germany needed was national, social, and political freedom, not war. We know a land where there is no fascism, a land where it would be unthinkable for the fascists to practice murder on the streets, carrying out their bloody actions in the working class districts. It is called the Soviet Union.
Irma cheered and cheered along with all the rest.
So we continue our fight against fascism, closely bound together with the international proletariat.
Chapter 2. The Nazis take power. Fritz Dietloff, Count von der Schulenburg, got married on the 11th of March, 1933. He was 31. His bride was Charlotte Klottenburg, a perfect match in every way. The day before the wedding, he was called in for a meeting with Hermann Göring, now busily employed creating the Geheime Staatspolizei, the Gestapo, the secret police designed to eradicate all opponents of the Nazis. Having joined the NSDAP as member 291342 a year before, the Count was seen as one of the up-and-coming, well-connected young men the Nazis were keen to attract. A proper Prussian aristocrat, no less, clever and with plenty of old-world charm. The meeting got off to a bad start, however, when Göring, lavishly attired in one of his smart uniforms, berated the young Count for his sloppy dress. Von der Schulenburg, with aristocratic disdain, and in fact not much money, brushed the rebuke off easily, and after some further discussion, Göring invited him to meet the Führer and some of his cronies. This was an unexpected honour, and meant that everyone waiting back at the Count's family apartment in Berlin, his parents, four brothers and sister, Tisa, were getting worried that Fritz Dietloff would be late for his Polterabend, stag night. Göring presented Schulenburg to the Führer as the Wild Count, indicating the casual dress. But Hitler didn't pay much attention, having more important matters on his mind. Fritzi, as he was known to his family and friends, managed to get back to the apartment just in time for the celebration. The next day, the happy couple were married at the Dreifaltigkeitskirche, Holy Trinity Church, the bride in white with a bouquet of lilies, the groom in his morning suit and silk top hat. His three older brothers, Johann Albrecht, Wolf Werner, known as Wolfi, and Adolf Heinrich, known as Heini, were all enthusiastic members of the Nazi party, as were the parents. Only Wilhelm, Fritzi's younger brother, held back, and Tisa, his sister. Tisa was anti-Nazi from the first. Charlotte was of a mind to support her new husband, whatever he did. She was 7 years younger than him and had given up her philology studies to marry. His parents couldn't have been happier. Charlotte was everything they could have wished of a daughter-in-law. Loving, attractive, intelligent without being too clever, happy-natured, wanting nothing more than to be a good wife and mother. Shortly before their marriage, Charlotte had visited Fritzi in Königsberg, where he'd been posted straight after the Machtergreifung, the Nazi power grab. He'd found himself a nice apartment there, he wrote to Charlotte, half an hour by train from Königsberg, in a beautiful and quiet country setting, just how he liked it, away from all the hustle and bustle and political infighting. He wrote to her almost every day, long letters and short, the long ones often about his political and social hopes and aspirations. She was his soulmate to the last. He reminded her that she'd married a dedicated worker who would never have a lot of time for her.
"But when I'm with you, you have my entire joy and love."
As though to prove the point, he called off the long honeymoon they'd planned, replacing it with a few days at Schloss Tressow, the family estate near Mecklenburg in northern Germany. She didn't mind. Snapshots taken of them at that time show a couple seated on the grass in a park, arms wrapped around one another, crazily in love. The odd one out in the Schulenburg family was Tisa. She and Fritzi had grown up doing everything together, there being only 18 months between them, but more than that because they were kindred spirits. Fritzi was different from their three elder brothers, more sensitive, more clever, and altogether more to Tisa's liking. When she was born on the 7th of December 1903 at Tressow, their father called his four small sons into his study to ask them what names they might give her. The four boys didn't know any girls' names. Rosenkranz, Rose Wreath, suggested one of them, trying his best. In the event, she was named Elisabeth, Mary, Carolina, Veronica, Margareta. Tisa for short. From the start, Tisa went her own way. No one in the family understood her, except Fritzi. Fritzi wasn't born at Tressow, but in London, where his father, Count Friedrich Bernhard von der Schulenburg, was military attaché at the court of St. James. His parents, who were close friends of the Kaiser, loved London. The place, the people, the banquets and balls, the country house weekends. In fact, all of court life in a vibrant international city. Potsdam, Schulenburg's regimental home, was a small garrison town by comparison. But the family wasn't often in Potsdam, moving from one provincial town to another following the father's postings. Home was Tressow. Tressow they loved. Fritzi and Tisa shared a room there till Fritzi was sent off to school, and they shared the nursery with Heini, where only English was spoken with Vicky, the English nursemaid. Later they shared a governess, Miss Bull, a vicar's daughter from the north of England, who took a dislike to Fritzi for no discernible reason other than perhaps his precociousness. From early on, Fritzi was a touch arrogant.
"Fritz Dietloff von der Schulenburg, I'll box your ears," she'd say, and did. Or she locked him in the dark cupboard under the stairs. "Tell Mama," said Tisa, but proud Fritzi never would. Afterwards, they'd escape into the parkland surrounding the Schloss, climbing trees, running races with their brothers, playing in the stables, sledging in the winter, bathing in the lake in the summer, and going on their daily walk with Miss Bull through the fields and the woods, Tisa in her English smocks, the boys in their sailor suits. Tisa did everything the boys did, refusing to be left out. "You're like a boy," they accused her. But only Tisa was allowed to sit on the silk chair in her mother's bedroom in the mornings, watching Maria brush Mutti's hair. In 1911, their father was transferred from one of his provincial postings back to Army High Command in Berlin. Now his trousers bore the wide red stripe down the side, and his boots were high and black and shiny. He had very blue eyes, their Vater, with bushy eyebrows and a handlebar moustache. He could laugh heartily, but he was strict too. They only saw him at the evening meal when they had to sit up straight and stay silent. Once Fritzi, the rebel, broke the silence and spoke. Vater frowned. To everyone's amazement, Fritzi said, "I can look like that too," knitting his brows. That got him punished. Perhaps he wasn't allowed to go to Zirkusbusch with its Chinese acrobats and fire eaters. Or perhaps he couldn't go roller skating. Tisa couldn't remember. But it was soon forgotten, and they were off with their brothers, jumping on the back of trams or riding the electric U-Bahn, exploring Berlin, newly vibrant following the unification of Germany and the rapid growth of the economy in the early years of the 20th century. Sometimes they were lucky and persuaded their grandfather, the Bismarck one on their mother's side, to take them for a drive in his automobile, which could go at 20 kilometers an hour. But holidays were always spent at Tressow, where they quickly reverted to the ways of country life. The The estate had several villages attached, and one of Tisa and Fritzi's favourite activities was to accompany their mother when she paid a villager a visit. Perhaps one of the old people living in the almshouses built for them by their father at the turn of the century. But whatever they did, be it Berlin, Potsdam, or Treso, Fritzi and Tisa did it together. The day came when Fritzi had to join his brothers at the gymnasium. Tisa, the girl, had to stay home. She begged and begged to be allowed to go to school too, and later she was allowed to attend the local art school because Tisa loved to draw and paint. But by then, Germany was embroiled in the Great War, with their father and two of her brothers already at the front, and Heine soon to join them, all three brothers volunteering at the first opportunity. Their mother cried, and their father warned of the senselessness of war, but nothing could stop them. By the end of the war, the father, who'd advised making peace as early as 1916, came home exhausted and bitter, and retreated to his room. Johann Albrecht and Wolfi were wounded. Heine returned hardened and disillusioned. Fritzi was too young to fight. But he did Grenzenschutz border patrol on the new eastern frontier with Poland and experienced firsthand the poverty and despair of the ordinary people, the ones who suffered most from the Reich's defeat. He was billeted with a farming family so poor they ate their potatoes straight from one big dish in the middle of the kitchen table. No plates. And often no food either. Later in Berlin, he fought the Communist Spartacus League on the barricades. When he came home, Tisa found him changed. Sharper, less talkative, more determined. And so thin, his mother at first didn't recognize her own son walking along the country road back to Treso. After recuperating, Fritzi went to the University of Göttingen. He took law and Staatswissenschaft, political science, preparing himself for a life in the Prussian civil service, very much in the Schulenburg tradition on both sides of the family. He read everything he could lay his hands on, including Marx and Lenin. Engulfed by political and economic crises, he and his student comrades drank and discussed late into the night, always battling with the same question, what to do to save the German Reich. He was the natural leader of the group, humorous, well-read and sceptical of quick solutions. He decided to go into training, for the self-discipline and to toughen himself up. Bodybuilding, fencing, swimming. To Tisa's surprise, he joined the student fraternity. It shocked her because it seemed to go against everything they'd talked about before, the urgent need for political change and reform of the old traditional ways in order to create a fairer society. But Fritzi being Fritzi didn't just join the fraternity, he got himself into a duel, resulting in a deep scar on his left cheek, which he had for the rest of his life. Tisa, meanwhile, drew and painted and flirted with the new ideas of socialism during those early Weimar years. Her parents worried. Why was she so different to the rest of the family? So argumentative, so rebellious, so unfeminine. How would she ever find a husband with views like that? By the time Fritzi and Charlotte got engaged in June 1932, he'd taken the usual steps along the Prussian civil service path. He showed early signs of promise and was quickly promoted. Off his own bat, he decided to get a transfer to Recklinghausen in the industrial and largely Catholic West Germany to see for himself how bad things were there. And things were very bad indeed, with every kind of social problem and unemployment even higher than in Prussia. The administrative paperwork piled up on his desk, but Fritzi was never one to get bogged down by that. He did the minimum, quickly and effectively, preferring to be out and about checking matters for himself. He made a point of meeting the workers and the unemployed, socialists and communists, and personally helped out some families financially. Everyone, including Fritzi himself, blamed the situation on the punishing terms of the Treaty of Versailles. And many of those he talked to preferred the Russians to the Western Allies. By autumn 1932, Fritzi had been transferred to Heiligenbeil in East Prussia. The fishermen there were suffering from the Huff sickness caused by eating contaminated fish. They couldn't work to earn a living and feed their starving families. No one in the administration was doing anything about it. Fritzi easily discovered the cause: polluted water from the local factories. He arranged a meeting with the factory bosses who refused to comply. When he warned them of disciplinary action, they still refused, knowing that this was just a junior official and the senior ones would surely turn a blind eye, as they always had. Fritzi demanded a meeting with the big boss, Landrat Gramsch, who referred the matter upwards. It was Fritzi's deep conviction that the civil service was there to serve not just the state, but the folk, whether at local, regional or national level.
I want to feel Germany's need as my own, carry the longings of millions of unhappy Germans in my own heart, and work for them as though it were my own fate, he wrote to a friend. I feel that I'm bound tightly to Germany with a deep love. I feel her pain and her need as though it were my own, and I see it as the highest duty, worth giving up a person's life, to fight for it, and to sacrifice oneself for it.
What the country needed, Fritzi was convinced, was strong, good leadership. A Führer. He joined discussion groups, went to meetings, gave lectures, did everything he could to help the folk. And if his convictions meant taking on the big landowners or the factory bosses or the local administrators, so be it. The Nazi propaganda machine, orchestrated by Josef Goebbels, was making a strong impression, and nowhere more so than in East Prussia, where the farmers' landfolk movement, which Rudolf Ditzen had written about so vividly, was on the march.
I've become a national socialist as a result of experiencing circumstances in northern Germany, where the party has become a folk movement,
Fritzi wrote to Charlotte.
There are good leaders there too, because I've realised there's no other flag under which this can be achieved. I know the shadow side of the party. I know many of the local leaders aren't great, but everything is on the move. It looks as though the Prussian and North German way will be able to win through.
Fritzi was deeply impressed by Gregor Strasser, who was on the left of the party, a man of intellect who was nevertheless of and for the folk. The economy would be reorganised by the Nazis, said Strasser, reining in the big banks who'd got them into so much trouble. They would have German socialism, not the capitalism of the Western Allies, nor the communism of the Russians. When Hitler came to Königsberg to give one of his Führerrede talks, Fritzi was there, all ears.
Hitler spoke mesmerizingly, he wrote to Charlotte, deeply serious. Everything he says is alive and lived. Here is a man who believes in something and believes every word he says and has stayed unpretentious about everything. This is a man who has become a real Führer, but has nevertheless not cut himself off from us, the folk. He may have made mistakes and have weaknesses, but he is the prophet, the educator, the man to believe in for the millions.
Goebbels came too, in April 1932, and again, Fritzi was impressed. To his delight, Goebbels stated categorically that National Socialism was based on old Prussian values.
The ideas we hold are Prussian. The aims which we mean to achieve in a much more modern fashion are those of Friedrich Wilhelm I, Friedrich the Great, and Bismarck. The folk wants us to bring back these Prussian values of state government.
How could idealistic Fritzi have known that Goebbels the day before had written in his diary,
"The fight for Prussia in the forthcoming elections is almost over. It's proceeding apace. We have 14 more days to achieve our aim. It's a masterstroke of propaganda."
And so, in January 1933, Hitler became Chancellor of Germany. And everything changed overnight. It only took 5 days from the Machtergreifung for the Nazis to pass the law for the protection of state and people, which restricted press freedom and freedom of assembly. On the 22nd of February, 50,000 auxiliary policemen were created, mostly attached to the Sturmabteilung, SA, the Nazis' paramilitary force since the early days, unleashing a wave of violence across the country against communists and socialists. The KPD communist headquarters in Berlin was raided and ransacked. On the 27th of February came the Reichstag fire, which the Nazis claimed was the work of communists. In reprisal, 10,000 communists were arrested. Hitler passed another law for the protection of people and state the following day, giving him emergency powers to restore order. All freedom of speech and assembly and the press were now suspended. The police were given powers to arrest and detain suspects indefinitely. By March, Oranienburg and Dachau concentration camps had been set up as prison/work camps for political opponents of the regime taken into protective custody. Germany had become a police state. On the 23rd of March, following the elections held on the 5th of March, came the Enabling Act. From now on, laws could be passed without the consent of the Reichstag, effectively making Germany a dictatorship. Gleichschaltung was immediately put into action, requiring total political and cultural alignment with Nazi ideology. Anyone who resisted, teachers, lawyers, businessmen, doctors, factory foremen, were now in danger of losing their jobs. Gleichschaltung was the key to everything, allowing the Nazis to hound any opponent of the regime, however small. The 1st of April marked the first boycott of Jewish shops and businesses, their doctors' surgeries and legal practices. 6 days later, the law for the restoration of the professional civil service was passed, purging it of all unreliable political elements, including in the universities. On the 2nd of May, the trade unions were dissolved. The 10th of May saw the burning of degenerate books. On the 22nd of June, the SPD, the Social Democrats, were officially banned, their assets seized. 3,000 prominent socialists were arrested. The party fled abroad, first to Prague, then Paris, and finally in 1941, after the Nazis subjugated France, to London. By July 1933, all political parties except the Nazi Party had been disbanded in Germany, and the Protestant churches were amalgamated to form a single Reich Church. 6 months is all it took. Back in Hamburg, Irma Thälmann, now 14, was distraught. Her father, Ernst Thälmann, leader of the German communists, had been arrested in Berlin on the 3rd of March at the KPD party headquarters. Many wondered why it hadn't happened sooner, but the Nazis held back from arresting someone so powerful in their first month for fear of civil unrest. They knew they needed time to win the people over. Hardly a third of the population had voted for them in the November election. The newsreels of hysterical crowds cheering Hitler as his car made its triumphal way through the streets of Berlin after the 30th of January 1933 were as much thanks to Goebbels' dark arts as a reflection of the feelings of the majority of the German people, most of whom stayed quietly at home, keeping their heads down, hoping for the best. Arresting Ernst Thälmann, the most charismatic and popular of leaders, would have been a dangerous mistake.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.